Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. In today's video, we will review the Microsoft Feed 3, the version mini, 128K in Strat, and in different formats. What we are going to do here is save the model for inference in different formats, MLflow with a Python model, GGUF and ONNX, and do inference and compare the different outputs versus time of inference and also the quality of the inference that the model provide. Once we are using quantization to save the model and load it obviously with that quantization. We start, first of all, I have prepared as usual some notebooks to later on you review on your local environment what I'm doing here. And I prepared today four, all of them related to how to work with the Microsoft Feed 128. Here I patch you some documentation from Microsoft about this model, the different options you had. It's quite interesting if you are familiar with the model, the performance, etc., all the documentation of the different versions you had and how to run it in different environments. So take a look just to get all the details. We start with MLflow, the saving the model in a PyFarm function in a Python model, so creating a wrapper with the MLflow and saving the model into the MLflow tracking server, and then on recover the model from the tracking server and do inference. We are going to do some basic example doing the solving a classification problem with an instruction. Yes, we send a text and we ask the model to classify in among two different classes. It's a binary classification problem, but done with a prompt. So I'm working on a Colab Pro here for the. Once we download the model, we will be using the GPU. We are using an L4 with 23 gigabytes, and let's go. We basically install what we need. This model is taking advantage of some specific improvements on the attention heads that had implemented Microsoft, the flash attention, and to optimize the use of this model in inference or in fine tuning, you need to have an adequate GPU. So in this case, the ones are available with these technologies are 800 or 800. So you want to use this at maximum performance, we should be using the A100. A100, I'm having currently issues to allocate one even in Colab Pro, so they are really demanded. So every time I try to allocate it, I'm being refused. So I finally use the L4 for this experiment. So we install the libraries that we need. We set up the MLflow environment. We are going to log everything in Databricks in a instance, a workspace I had now in Amazon. We set up the environment variables, the tracking URI, the host, and the Databricks token to access MLflow. We just filter some warnings, import the libraries we need. We are using MLflow 2.14. We download the model from Hugging Face, the Feed 3 Mini 128K. You probably know that this model had two versions per size. We had three different sizes. We have mini with 3.4 billions. The other, let me remember. We had, sorry, this information is essentially here. a version with 7 millions and a version with 13 billions. Here you have it better. We had the mini 3.8 billions, small 7 billions, and medium 14 millions. Okay, and we go with a logic. We again the mini 3.8. We create our class to wrap the model in a Python model with pyfunc. So we need to define the load context method, which essentially is loading the tokenizer from a path that we will pass on the context artifact in the context. Sorry, this is a dictionary that we pass once we load the save the model into MFlow, and then I'll just define that we are going to use quantization brainflow 16. We load the configuration as well into the config, and we load the model as well with brainflow 16. We move to CUDA, to the GPU, and we put the model in evaluation. So now we create just a simple method to build the prompts. Here we will receive the input that the user sent, and we will insert this input into this specific prompt. You need to build it like this in order to get the optimal answer from the model. We create the predict function. This is the you need to define the predict method. Usually you need to generate the context as well. When you instantiate the model, as you will see there, you are calling the load context method, and this is the stuff that MFlow will use to access to your model, your tokenizer, and everything that the MFlow need to later load the model in other environment. And then you need to code your predict function and adapt it to the specifics of the model that you are working on. Here essentially we are just using a transformer or a generative AI model, so essentially we are just taking the prompt, tokenizing the prompt, building the prompt with the input of the user, encoding the prompt, putting the prompt on the GPU, and generate. How we generate with our tokenized prompt, and we use those sample true and temperature and mass token. I will explain you now there. Then on, we remove the prompt from the tokenizer and decode only the answer of the model. Okay, and then we return the generated response. Here we are generating all the necessary information to create the signature of the model, and also define how the input and the output should be, and also the parameters that we will be able to modify later on after loading the model from our MFlow tracking server. So here we define the input. The input is now, probably you are aware of that, is I think I already provide this information in some of the previous videos I did about MFlow on the channel. But here you have now in MFlow, when you build the input, we don't need to do an inference, and the MFlow will infer about how the input and the output of the inference is in order to create the objects that later will be create the model car in the experiment. So now we just define it similarly like we create in an schema in PySpark, defining the an object schema and all the necessary attributes that you need or form the input of your model. In this case we only had a string, which is our prompt, but for example, if you are working with a vision model, we have here a NumPy array or a tensor which are shape. The output exactly the same. We define an schema for the output. In this case it's only attribute, which is the candidate, which is also a string. And the signature as well may include, it is necessary, most of the generative AI models have parameters that you can modify at inference level. So what you specify here, they will be the only parameters that you will later be able to modify at inference time. So if you are planning to use, for example, top P, top K, whatever other either you fix it like here to sample on the class, or write a parameter with something with a default value here, and then on if you don't send it, MFlow will use the default value, and it is not, you can define a new temperature and use it in your inference at any time. So again, if you plan to use, for example, top P or top K, just introduce a param spec here and provide a default value. Now we create the model signature with our input schema, output schema, and the parameters, and we define an input example. We are working in MFlow, so we set the experiment with the name, the format that is necessary for MFlow, so workspace user, slash user, slash user in the database workspace, and a name. And here we just simply set the model, log model method, from PyFarm. This is standard across any model that you serialize into Dix, into the tracking, or into the tracking server. And then here we are not using any, we are using the generic flavor PyFarm, because we define our model as a class which embed a generative AI model, a V3 model, sorry. And then again, we lock the model. This is the name of the path inside the experiment where you will have all the artifacts. We instantiate the class. Now, once you instantiate the class here, you essentially call the context method. The context is going to, let me exactly cut the context will be called as soon as you create it, so it will load the tokenizer, the model, and it will save this into MFlow tracking server. So you see here that the path is the context artifact snapshot, and you can see here that we are instantiating this to the path where we download the model with just here. Snap location, snapshot download, this is downloading our model to local, essentially to this folder. Then on we lock the model, we also pass the PIP requirements. This is one of the ways. Here we are just manually defining the environment where this model needs to run when you download it in another environment. Usually I prefer to MFlow do it itself, because this is usually prone to error and you may forget some of the key libraries that you need when you download the model in another environment. But here, well, we did it like this just to show that this is also possible. Input example and signature. So now we upload the model. So you look at here, let me refresh. The last one with that one, you have your experiment in MFlow, the run ID, the log model, and here we don't have obviously anything because we didn't train the model. And in artifact, as you remember, under the V3 instruct, you have the artifacts. This is exactly your model, exactly the same that you have here. And where is this? Oh, sorry. And you had all the metadata that you need to later load the model. You had the card with all the content. What is your virtual environment file? The model that you need to load. Where is the Python model? The Python model is here. The picker. As you remember, if you don't remember, what we do here is just we take the object class. And we serialize it in Pickle. In Pickle, we are doing reference to this folder. So what is doing this Pickle file is just an object in Pickle format. We do this with the library Cloud Pickle, and then what is doing the model is serializing this object, an instance of this object, and this object is pointing to this path to load the tokenizer, etc., etc. If you see here, the path is essentially what we had in here. Sorry, this is the path where you will find everything, and we pass the folder. It will be with the same name as you had the so the artifacts, the real artifacts to upload are in this path, and then on you will be finding in this V3 instruct folder in Databricks. As you can see here, artifacts, and you had exactly with the same name that were downloaded in your system. So this object here, Python model PGL, sorry, it's just an instance of this class, and this class is doing reference to this folder in the model registry. Later, when you download, what you are gonna do is just load this instance, and this instance, when you download the model to your local environment, first of all, it will look at the metadata, create the environment, or must try to match the environment with what you had in the conda.yaml file or Python environment, depending which type of environment you are using, and then only will download the files according to what is specified on the object class. And this is essentially what we do here. We just load the model with from the URI. Let me show you what is written down here in model URI info. You have the run ID and the folder, and then if you check is 2582, and this is essentially this run ID, and it's pointing. So we are loading the model from this path, and once you have it, we can start to do inference. Here we just create some text. These are two different texts. We just make a simple classifier, CV, non-CV, and we create a prompt. Later, you can go to the details. Here, take 3 seconds in doing inference, and it was correct. This again is floating point. You see here we are floating point 16, so the model is on the GPU. And here we do the second example with the other document, and as well it generates correctly the answer and the time. Well, here we are loading the model first time to the GPU, and here second time is obviously faster, because the model is already in the GPU. We just transfer the data to the GPU, and we do the inference. Okay, so that's it for MLflow. Now we move to the GGUF with Llama CPP. So let me prepare it, and as soon as I have it ready, I will continue with the video. Okay. I already run it. So here now in this notebook, we are going to use Llama CPP and the format GGUF. You probably know Llama CPP was created by Gerganov. This is an implementation purely in C plus C, C plus plus, and then we had an interface to work in Python, but essentially under the hood it's everything working in C, C plus plus. You will see that that way is speeding up the inference, even in the case that you work with the Python interface. But as majoritarily the code is done in C and it's a compiled language, a DLL, and then is running really, really fast. And then the format that we will use is GGUF, which is the new version that replaced the GGML. Is as well a binary format with essentially reduce the size of the model. There is different types of quantization you can check here. We are going to use a floating point 16 and compare it with the other version that we had in or we tried before with MLflow. So you have here all the links to look for the relevant information and how as well to download and install Llama CPP, the Python library, with support, GPU support. Okay? You can follow anyway here on the notebook. You have all the commands. Here we just install Hugging Face Hat and the HFI transfer. We download the model. Here is this one you had in this URL I have here. All the versions that we had available in GGUF user of the Hugging Face, and here then on the install of Llama CPP Python, and well, that's it. Again, the arguments to take a look to the documentation if you had a specific hardware or you just want to run it in CPU is also possible. But well, in this case we are installing with GPU support and compiling the binary, not the binary, the library at that time. Here we clean the cache because here I will explain you in this implementation. Obviously here to load the model we just import Llama from Llama CPP, and then you point to the path of the model where you download it. I here download it into Content Drive, My Drive Model, GUFP P3, and then on you had the file there. You can take a look, Drive, My Drive Models, GGUF, PY3, and here you had the model, the file itself. Here the max, the number of tokens that you will use on. Yeah, as soon as you as much tokens you want to use, the most memory that you will claim to the GPU. So here we are using a 23 gigabytes. So here with this, in this test we are using just 8.1, but we can do a try if you want to just try to produce a context of 24,000 tokens. This is the number of layers that you will accelerate and the number of threads. You try to do this, yeah, we will exploit, no? We will get out of memory, as you can see here, because yeah, we try to allocate more memory than we have on our GPU. So if you had a better memory, try to do this. Clean, you want to load it now, just clean the memory and delete the object if there is, and just simply load it with that size. And you will see here that we are able to just simply do it. You can see here the context, patch, the size of the model. Here GGUF number 3. we use the same prompts and we just run it. And here it should work faster. Here 1.336 seconds in comparison with the other one is practically half of the output. This is the first try. Is we load the data of the model to the GPU, and here we apply to the second one, and it will be faster, a little bit faster than the previous one. And in comparison with the previous stuff, yeah, the prompt is correct. Just remember that here it took 3 and 1.70. So it's faster, obviously, because the underhood implementation is working in C++, which speed up a lot the inference. Now, let's move to the next example. Here we are going to use ONNX, this library. This is a runtime which allows us as well to run not only like Llama in GPU and CPU, and also in this case allow us to run in the TarentML, which is the library that Microsoft implement as something equivalent to NVIDIA or CUDA in this case, but just for a Windows environment. Then we are going to do two tests. One is in CPU. Why we don't do it in GPU? Because for GPU is only ready for CUDA, up to CUDA 11.8, and here in my machine I had 12.1, and here as well we had 12.1 as well. Oh, sorry, I need to connect, and then we need to build the whole library from scratch, and it's gonna take a lot of time. And then, in terms of the performance, is gonna be very similar in NVIDIA to what we got with GUF. Here we are trying with a smaller model, even because we do a quantization of the integer 4, so this model is 4 times smaller than the float in 16. This is 4 times smaller and 8 times smaller than the original one. So we will run the inference in the GPU with you check here NVIDIA SME. So you will check we have a 12.2 here. We need to compile the library completely from scratch to with CUDA support, with CUDA 12.1 support. So I will run now I think I had everything here. So here just we install this. Let me check it is something. Yeah. We are going to download a model which they claim to be working on CPU and mobile devices. You have here in the runtime the different versions of the V3 with all the alternatives and how to run it in all these environments. I will pass you as well. You can check the tutorials. It's pretty interesting technology. Something that you need to have as well on your radar, because especially for small environments where the memory is a problem, or small CPUs like the ones that we have in edge technology or in smartphones, this is something that is really really sweet for those environments. In comparison with the other ones, I will say that they were having Llama is an equivalent to ONNX in the cloud. So you can decide to use one or the other. If you have a requirement as well to run in Windows, this is a very good alternative. It is running in combination with the DirectML. So if you had you can use this other technology, this other library, which is also implemented in C++, and it's going really fast. Not in my computer, which I had a very very small GPU, but GPU like the ones that we use on the cloud is performing very very well. So if you had to run your inference in a Windows device, this is a very good alternative because you had an alternative possibility to use libraries like DirectML, which are implemented in C++, and this is doing a very good job in that environment. So let's review here. Now we download the model. I think it will be very fast because I already have it. It's fast. I installed the libraries. It's already done. I suppose that ONX Runtime Genie is already there as well. So now I just import the libraries and I load the model from the path I downloaded. It's gonna take a while. Let's check just 1 second. We can go here to the drive. CD drive. My drive models. So this is PCDPi3 CPU. 128 CPU and mobile. If we look at now what we had here, we had another directory, CD CPU. So this model is just 2.7 gigas, with a still very big. Usually in a CPU, this model, who doesn't have today 2-3 gigabytes of memory in RAM, no? It's usually all of us had, at least for example, my machine has 64 gigabytes of RAM, so this is nothing for my machine. But yeah, for a GPU, you will see the same model, but working in my machine in with DirectML, and for my GPU with 4 gigabytes of memory, this is too much. Okay. Let's check what we have here. We run the models, and then remember that we are gonna work in the CPU, so it will take some time additionally. So let's run all the cells. I will stop it here, and then once it's done, I will finish this part of the tutorial. Okay, here we are. So in CPU took the first try 38 seconds. Produced a correct classification, and the second try as well correctly took 23 seconds. So obviously, the time is considerably. Higher or longer, no, that they're doing in a GPU, but you can see that we can use a very this problem is not simple. Take a look to the size of the test. You usually don't send this kind of text in a mobile device, or because this is this model is designed to run in a small computer where you usually interact with small questions, probably in a computer. So it will reduce the size of the test that we send as instruction. This is probably going very much faster. It's something that probably is going to be acceptable if we are running with a small device. And we had the power of a model of that of this quality, latest technology that is able to run in a CPU. And also for those that doesn't have a CPU, well, again, you can use a very powerful model in a CPU and take advantage even in a local environment. You can run this even if you don't have a GPU in your computer. If you look at the resources, yeah, we didn't use the GPU. We are just using practically no RAM in this computer. It's just 4.4 gigabits, which in many small devices is some of the memory that you may have, no, available to run the model, or to load it in memory at least. Okay, and the latest example we will do is gonna be on my local computer. We will use as well ONNX with DirectML. Again, DirectML is this library from Microsoft, designed in C++, and it's working with DirectX 12. This probably you are familiar with this library. Was designed for accelerated graphics in Windows. It's very, very old library. There is, and well, you can take a look. There is a very interesting things that you can do with Windows AI and this library. They have plugins for Python, Torch, many other things. And well, it's a very good alternative, especially if you have a good GPU, like it's not my case, no? Because, well, here I also give you some instructions how to install this. You install in Windows, in a cond environment I have. You essentially download as well the model, Microsoft ONX. Include the DirectML. Look at here, we include in this download, in the other version, we include CPU and mobile. The int for RTM block. Here we include essentially the DirectML. And well, we check my NVIDIA. I had the version 12.3. It's a NVIDIA G4 GTX 1650. It's almost full, my memory. Only 22% free. But I think it's even less. Okay, so we load the model here. It's gonna take a while, and we just run the same examples with the same configuration. And then on as well, it's gonna take a while until everything is done. So the model probably, yeah, it's already in memory. And here, yeah, my GPU is taking a lot of time again, because the processor, the graphic processor, is very slow in comparison with the one I've been using in Google Colab, and then it's taking a lot of time, and also it's very, very busy. My GPU is working with many things. You probably know that when you are working in a local desktop in Windows, many things of your browser or your Microsoft Teams or many applications now move some processing to the GPU, and you are always using the GPU. So you have a, probably I can run here the Task Manager. And then you can see here that my GPU is very busy. Probably the GPU, yeah, the GPU is practically full And the GPU is yeah. Vaya. I suppose that this in a better in a server or using a better GPU. This one I have is a little bit slow. Yeah, this inference will perform much better. Okay. And here we are. The inference took in the first case 2 minutes, and in the second case 1 minute, which well is better than the CPU, but in this case we could try as well to because it's possible to run as well with DirectML in the CPU, but using a better GPU this time is improving dramatically. Using that small GPU, you can use it, and the output, as I said, is okay. You can run the inference in your local computer, but the time, well, probably also is not the most appropriate example to use on the local computer, because again this is, I just replicated as well some of the use case I'm working on and try to replace a classification model I have with T5. I try to change it to use now this model, which is powerful, but using a quantized version in either Unix or Windows environment. So well, it's not bad. A little bit in any case, probably because again I'm using my local GPU and it's very busy, not simple. My opinion, I need probably is, as you can see, in my GPU is fully busy. Probably the problem is when I try to load the model and do inferences, need to remove some of the applications that I had in memory and do the inference, and then on the applications returns to the GPU again. That's why it's taking longer, because yeah, the capacity of my GPU is very small. So probably with a bigger one also will go faster. As you can see here, the memory is busy, it's completely occupied, even now, without running the inference. Okay, that's all. Thank you very much for watching. I hope that it was useful and informative for your job, your training, or whatever, or for whatever reason that you are watching this video. I just introduce you some formats that I'm testing as well for my job, for some of the use cases I'm working on, and then I'm exploring what is going to be the best alternative. And I explore recently as well the new library that Intel just released to do inference with using the transformers in Intel GPUs, which up to now you probably know that it was impossible or practically impossible to run inference in an Intel GPU. Now you can do it. There is a very powerful library competence now for NVIDIA, and now these other alternatives where you know, at least you save money in terms of the GPU that you may use. You don't need to use a bigger one. You can use a smaller one with a small model quantized, which means that keeping the time and keeping the quality of the prediction, we can spend less money in our infrastructure doing exactly the same job that we do with a bigger one, which is one of the objectives I had, at least on the use case I'm working on right now. And okay, that's all. Thank you very much again for watching. Give me a like if you like the content and it was useful for you. Subscribe to the channel if you and not already subscribed, and then on share with your friends and colleagues just to help me to promote the channel in YouTube. I will post now the four notebooks to the repo, and I will put you on the description of the video how to get them to later on you work on your local environment. Thank you very much. See you soon.